this together, organize this talk, and I'm hoping that we'll be the first of many discussions about how the changes in publication will be affecting the university community. So again, thank you all very much for being here, and welcome, and have a good forum. Unfortunately, I can't stay and hear much of it because we have another event going on that I have to be at, but it's being recorded and I'll get to look at it. So thank you all and have a good forum.
Hi, welcome from me too, Carole Kiehl, Dean of University Libraries, and I want to thank Gordon Cannon, the Office of the Vice President for Research, and also the current Office for the Provost for co-sponsoring this open forum, which will be hopefully the first of many, because as Dr. Cannon said, publishing is changing rapidly, and we need to keep up with those changes. So my job was to just give a very brief overview of academic publishing, the past, and some of the changes and challenges, and then I'm going to hand over to the panel who will talk about their personal experiences with academic publishing. So I'll just talk briefly, very briefly, about traditional academic publishing, some of the new models and open up access publishing. Then we have our expert faculty panel, forums and questions, so we'll open the floor to questions and welcome those, and then we'll talk about future considerations. So, as Dr. Cannon said, publisher perish, tenure and promotion standards for producing journal articles, books and chapters, and research findings were really important and to the faculty. And I think probably academia is the only enterprise which has acted this way, which is that the faculty do research, they do the writing, in other words, they produce the product, then they give their product away to the publishers, sometimes signing over all rights, and so that you can share your research and scholarly findings. And then the publishers sell them back to the academy via the libraries at sometimes extortionate pricing. So, you know, it is a very odd model, and nobody else would do this, I mean, really, but we do it. So it was important, of course, to publish in certain journals for peer review, and that was considered essential. And pretty much always traditionally faculty gave up all copyright, gave up all rights to their own product. So that is a little, as I say, it's unusual. So the new model of academic publishing, and it is part of the issue is that it's in such quick evolution, is internet availability. So it's easier to share information. So you have, and then there's the need for access to research information and changes in technology. So it's the technology that's really driving a lot of changes. It expedites submission and review process, or it can do. And there's also new mandates for access, new government mandates for access, for instance, from the National Institute of Health. It requires publishing findings within a certain amount of time if you're to accept the funding dollars. And more government bodies are going that way. So it's going to become more and more important that you have a means of sharing that information and sharing it quickly. And as we know, some publishing is a little slow. Online subscriptions have totally changed the way libraries operate. Everything in the libraries have changed so much. We have to have computing, staff have to have different skill sets, and I just keep trying to make sure everybody understands that just because you access materials in your office, it doesn't come through the internet and it's not free. We are paying at times phenomenal amounts of money for some of these electronic resources. So, the open access is a big new thing, and some of those initiatives, actually it's not so new. If you have a look, the Santa Fe Convention in 1999 It created an organizational framework and a technical structure for archiving electronic publications, such as the physics preprint archives. And then in 2001, the Budapest Open Access Initiative promoted international cooperation to make research freely available on the internet. And there's over 600 worldwide labs, research organizations, foundations, and medical centers who have signed this initiative. So in some ways, some other countries are able to, you know, unite and make sure that all of their libraries are open, all of their publications are open. Smaller countries, this is a large country. So government mandates, again, those mandates are demanding open publishing of research findings. And there's, okay, other government agencies include NASA, NOAA, EPA, NIST, who are also considering requiring open access publications. So to get the funding, it's becoming more and more important that researchers think about open access. Now, some of the advantages of open access is that it's more accessible. They're more likely to be used by researchers if they're found readily and freely on the internet. So a broader population has access them to them, not just subscribers to journals. So that's important. There is reliable preservation in digital archives. That was a concern some years ago about what happens. Are these materials secure? Will they be preserved? There are methods for perpetual access to digital materials. And technology, again, simply enhances finding these materials. So what are the open access challenges? Author concerns. Some authors are afraid that other scholars may view open access publications as less prestigious. This is sort of gradually being eroded as more and more open access journals are coming available and are becoming prestigious. So it's an evolution and it will take time. So also authors were concerned that their work was more accessible or would be more susceptible to plagiarism, which is true. If more people can find it, more people can plagiarize, but you know, plagiarism it's a bad thing and we just have to watch out for it, no matter where it occurs. Some open access journals charge author fees to sort of fund their publishing. So in some cases, that is a concern for authors. And in some, at some universities, it's partially funded or it's assisted. And so those are some options to help with that. And tenure and promotion procedures once placed precedence on commercial publishing and on publishing in specific journals. But open access journals more and more are completely peer reviewed and it's exactly the same process and should have exactly the same respect. And some disciplines have moved much more readily to open access than others. And it seems that science like physics was an early adopter, whereas humanities are not moving as fast towards that. So academic publishing and digital archives, we have institutional repositories, which are digital communities that house the scholarly works produced at a university or institution. E-prints archives that started in 2001, E-print Soton in Southampton University. And in 2006, that university mandated that all faculty and student research is archived in the repository. And more, there are letters of support from presidents stating that the product of the university has to be openly accessible. So, and then there's the Open Door database, which is the directory of open access repository. It highlights over 1,800 online repositories worldwide as of last year. Coalition of Open Access Policy Institutions. These were faculty-led open access policies where the faculty have declared that they support open access. And there are a number of major universities who are who have declared that they support open access over others. And this sort of leads into, you know, it's also, it's trying to weaken some of the major publishers whose inflation rate has been quite phenomenal over the last several years. So, and I'm not naming names, but, you know, it gives the people an option that for affordable publishing. So there's lots of prestigious universities in there, including Emory, Harvard, and so on. I'm not going to read all through them. We now have here at Southern Miss, we have the opportunity of open access discovery in Aquila, which is the university's digital community. And this is now up and running and available for those of you. A lot of people have seen it. There are those of you who may not have seen this yet. And after the forum, you can visit aquila.usm.edu. And we've got some early adopters already who are uploading their materials there. We've got a newsletter publishing on there from the School of Library Information Science who are being early adopters. And so it's pretty much limitless storage. We can put a lot of research in there. It's highly indexed, so it's your research, your name is found very readily on the throughout the world. So it's definitely something to consider, and the libraries is managing that. So you'll hear more about that from Corrie. The panel's experience, they're going to talk about their research, their creative activities, and publishing, and how that, what they've been doing, and how, where they think that might lead. So I'm going to hand over now to Corrie Marsh, who's going to moderate the panel discussion and the panel. So I welcome our distinguished panel to discuss their experience with open access publishing, or academic publishing in general. So thank you.
I was just thinking when Carol was talking about the cost of things, I was working on next year's budget for the collection for the library resources the other day, and I was checking consumer indexes to try to get some feel for what journals and databases increases might be. Right now, just this year, our average has been 3 to 5% cost increases. We've actually had some resources that are as much as 12-15%. One of our most used databases, the Project Muse databases of retrospective journals, actually this year cost us 18% cost increase this year. And when I was looking through the index of these increases, thinking next year's going to be an average of around 5 to 8% increases, I get right across the fact that the new Lexus RX for 2013 is going to have a controversial 1% price increase. So you can see the huge difference between what our library resources are costing and the kinds of economics I have to practice in budgeting that, and the everyday things in life when people get outraged when prices go up 1% to 2% on consumer products. We have a panel representing a large, broad range of disciplines this morning. They're faculty who's been involved in writing and editing and scholarly publications. Unfortunately, two of our panelists were unable to make it. Dr. Kamali has been delayed in air travel, and Dr. Song has graciously filled in for Dr. Banerjee, who is unable to join us today because his first child has been induced early, so we've been delayed with that. Dr. To Song is the Associate Professor and Chair of the School of Computing Science. Dr. Song has published in the BMC Bioinformatics and Genomics Journals. Dr. David Daves is the Associate Professor of Curriculum Instruction and Special Education, and he's published in the Journal of Instructional Pedagogies. Dr. Andrew Paley is the Associate Professor of History, and we discovered him on the web because of his research in using open internet resources for his publications, and the universities where he's performed that research were promoting him as a researcher of their online resources. Dr. Fengwei Bai is the Associate Professor of Biological Sciences and editor of the Open Access Journal of Internal Medicine. Dr. Biswas is the Assistant Professor of Physics, and he's on the editorial board of the Open Access Journal ISRN, Condensed Matter Physics. And Dr. Sheila Davis is Professor of Nursing and the founding editor of the Online Journal of Health Ethics. We appreciate it. Dr. Biswas, would you like to start the conversation and remarks?
Yes. Well, I think it's such a wonderful time to discuss about open access. At first glance, it's a beautiful idea, because all you want that the knowledge should be free, the scholarly information and the knowledge. But at the same time, it comes with the responsibility that the free knowledge, the quality of the knowledge. So if I have to pay for publication or the funding agency, then there is a question about the quality of that funding. But at the same time, it's going to stay. This is the new ideas. And what we expect that in the coming days, more and more journals are coming up. So we cannot overlook that. The idea would be we look into some of the merits and demerits associated with open access and discuss that and come up with a very good peer review system. The open access already have a peer review system. From time to time, I get the papers to review as a part of the editorial board. And often some papers are very good, which are the same as many of the journals, the traditional journals, for which I also review. So qualities are often are very good, but sometimes you also find the qualities which are very bad. So one has to have some kind of a very good peer review system, like in the traditional journal, so that the quality is maintained. And that's one of the most important point. And other than that, the case for open access are always there. Because in some field, for example, if it's a health science, the social sciences, we really want to know what is happening. I want to know what is the recent status of medical research, for example, diabetes. And this information, the research information which funded by this, you know, the taxpayer money should be available. I don't have to go and be a member of an institution as a member of a general public to get that information. So as a educated and technically oriented public, people should have the ability and the affordability to access this information. So that's my quick viewpoint on this part.
Thank you. Dr. Zhang.
Okay, my area is computer science and computational science. And computational science is an area, it's an interdisciplinary area. So we have a collaborative research, it's computer science and the biology and other areas. So my publication experience, including the regular long open access journal papers, that's a good journal paper, could be image processing, medical imaging, and biomedical physics, this kind of type of journal, prestigious journal in this area. And also including some open access journals, including BMC series, BMC bioinformatics, BMC genomics, and computational biology. And the other one is plus bioinformatics journals. So the open access journals are very important in this area, so to facilitate the access for other researchers. And actually all these open access journals are put in the database, we call it PubMed, widely accessed, and also many researchers do the research in this area called text mining. Develop another tools to search these journal papers. You put the title, keywords, especially the keywords, so that I can, you know, list the result and find all those related papers. Those papers related to your research interest, research area, so you can quickly access, you know, those papers. So that one issue is the quantity. about this open access paper journals. Actually, as to my knowledge, all these papers, you know, have been strictly peer reviewed. So the quantity is indicated by the impact factor. Impact factor is 4.0 or above. That's pretty good in this area. And the advantage, I already mentioned that, can be easily accessed by many people, so you get another good citation. It's good for us to disseminate our research results quickly and seek the collaboration opportunities. so the other type of publications in my area is conference proceedings. That's a difference, maybe different from other areas. So in computer science, there are many conferences. So this conference usually, you know, you send me your conference paper and get a peer reviewed and published in the conference proceedings. So the quality of this conference is indicated by the acceptance rate. So some top conferences very low acceptance rate, even 15%, 20%. So that's usually very compared to your conference paper. So we encourage, you know, our student faculty and myself to attend this top conferences. So in our school, the evaluation of these publications, you know, regular journal paper, that's okay, but a conference paper, we also count. Partial credit is important. One example is in computer science, one Turing Award winner. So he published the papers in the conference, and never published in the journal that result. But based on that result, he won the Turing Award. That's the most prestigious award in computer science. So computer science, because technology, so the new model, the new method of change, you know, quickly is different from physics, maybe biological science. So this requires us to quickly establish your result and to have the, you know, new advances in this area. So I served as a guest editor of several journals and organized the international conferences. So I would like to share this information with everybody. If you have any questions, thanks.
Compared to other experts, I don't have a lot of experience. But recently I involved as editor for a new open access journal, Internal Medicine. This is journal, they have this published group, they have a lot of journals. This focus on biomedical science. So, but this journal is a kind of a new journal. They just started this year. And right now, they are not regularly publishing because you know, they don't have a lot of papers submitted. You know, as a open access this kind of journal, in the beginning, people just watch like how the journal gonna be. So just like before, I also published one paper in open access journal Polos Pathogens. So in the beginning, this journal come up, so I just watched because there's no impact factor. So we, you know, we do research for several years. We put a paper together. We know this paper gonna be what kind of a journal. So we don't want to, you know, rush to submit it to a journal we don't know, right? So for after 3 years, so they turn out they have this kind of a journal, they come out to have internal, I'm sorry, for the impact factor. This is really good, actually. So right now they are have very strict peer review standards. So not easy to get this kind of open access journal. So, but for the beginning, for the new open access, I will suggest that we need to watch how the review goes, the standards for the review of the paper. So for the kind of a journal, whatever level of the journal. So we do not rush to submit this your good paper to this kind of journal we don't know. So this is my experience and about this open access journals.
When I started the tenure promotion process, obviously the question about publication was addressed. And so I said, well, I have some things in print, and I was told they wouldn't count because I didn't do them here. And then even if I had done them here, they wouldn't count because of the nature of the work. And so I said, well, what does count? Well, I'm not really sure. You'll have to show us, we'll tell you yes or no. And by the time you do that, it's sort of too late. And I was warned about vanity publications where you pay for print. And so when I submitted an article that was I knew peer reviewed and I got feedback from it and they said they liked it. In fact, they loved it and they're gonna print it, whatever the month was, and send them $80. And so I thought instantly there's a problem because I've been warned about this. And so I called and talked to the editor and he explained to me the process as far as peer review, as far as how this happens, and the fact that this type of publication was so much cheaper for everybody to have access to, that somebody's got to pay for it somewhere, and that's where the author's money comes in. And so I had really good experience with that journal in particular. I've not submitted to any other open access, but I do feel strongly that the peer review is the heavier part of that issue anyway. And these are all peer-reviewed that I have seen are all peer-reviewed and have the same integrity as any other type of publication. I do have the opinion that it's going to be very difficult for me before I die, unless that's pretty soon, to ever find a hard copy of anything. I think that books, journals in general, those are things that obviously times are constantly changing. If you Google open access and look at there's some pretty interesting charts as far as the number of increases in different disciplines that you see, that really the physics science is the head, the humanities is a little behind, but it shows you kind of a year over year and a half basis, the increase in publications, the increase in usage of that. Obviously you have access to that information much more available. Our libraries aren't stuck with $25,000 yearly fees for different publications. Some of these things are really amazing as far as the cost. And so there's just a lot of positives. I think this is a timely discussion to have as far as university, because it may be something that the department or the VP for research could find some money to assist in these. I know that you mentioned that other universities do have some assistance in that, and it's a very active part of research that I think is going to get bigger and bigger and more important as we get deeper into different technologies.
Thank you. Dr. Davis. Hi, I'm Sheila Davis, and I'm sitting here trying to be objective. But 8 years ago, I started the Online Journal of Health Ethics. Although I'm a nurse, it's an interdisciplinary journal. It's peer-reviewed, and I would like to think that the quality of our journal parallels the quality of hard copy journals. When we started that journal, I was on faculty at the University of Mississippi Medical Center, and they were very excited about it, a lot of support in that academic community for this journal. And they wrote this paper indicating that we were the first all-online ethics journal. And we were, but we were challenged by the scathing editorial from the University of Pennsylvania in our hometown newspaper, challenging our claim to be the first all online, but we really were. Since that time, we have published each year. We publish only twice a year, but we have an international audience. It was exciting for us to be picked up by Google, and Google helped us more than probably anything else. We will publish on Monday, and in Monday's journal, we have a submission from Nigeria, submissions from India, we have a submission from just a number of other places. It's been a good experience for me, very difficult our journal is free. We don't charge anything. We do this. This is missionary work for us. You spoke to the high impact. That was not, we didn't start out with that mission. I really wanted to create an open door. So we have labored very, very diligently, especially with submissions from countries that speak English as a second language. That has been most difficult, but we have been, I think, triumphant in bringing those masses together. We've had a lot of submissions from graduate students, doctoral students who, Dr. Davis, I need this publication so that I can graduate. And we've just been very sympathetic to that. And I'm sure as the journal grows, we will reach the high echelon where we have the high impact factors. But right now, we really are a service journal. The inspiration for this journal comes from a physician who I think is from Hattiesburg. Dr. Tatum, Helen Tatum, we at the medical center, each year we had the Tatum Ethics Series, and I was just so impressed by that and was led to do a little more along those lines. I was asked to develop and teach an interdisciplinary ethics course, and the papers coming out of that course, to me, were worthy for others to see. So I started the process of getting information and getting permission to just have a site on the university website to post the papers. And some people were excited and other people dragged their feet. But it took 2 years, but that idea morphed to the journal. It's just been a good experience for me. And we need reviewers if anyone's interested. But I think that's the way we're going to go.
Thank you. Dr. Kiehl.
Well, my story's a little bit different. As Dr. Kiehl said early on, and it's been repeated, and correctly so, the humanities and to some degree the social sciences are well behind in publishing in open source journals. So my experience is more of a user. And as a historian who has had the advantage of working with the large number of documents that have become available, documents from the late 19th and early 20th century, that because they're outside of copyright, libraries and other institutions have made them available. So I'd like to say that I've seen the future and it's in the past. As a historian, I get to work with these documents that are often outside of copyright protection and are made freely available to historians through archives and through online sources. And so through private and public initiatives, everything from Google Books to Michigan State's cookbook collection in my case, or the Hearth collection at Cornell, and now potentially our own Aquila system, I've had access to thousands of works that, you know, not that long ago, I would have had to have spent a considerable amount of time and money and hassle to access. Now I can access them, often with keyword searching, in a way that is easier and more available, and I can share them with my students in ways that are that allow them to be part of the research process. But I've also seen in recent years the things that can go wrong, and so as a user, I have some insights hopefully to share here. You know, when these resources are left entirely to the private to private industries, historical materials, even those that are out of copyright and in theory free, can be restricted and may become too expensive for most students and scholars to access. For example, ProQuest. ProQuest is a company that provides some of these resources. And they maintain an exceptional collection of historical newspapers that's easily searchable. And in my field, in my time period, the period I study is really the go-to resource. In the past, when the leading technology was microfilm, libraries like ours purchased that microfilm, a one-time purchase, and we owned it. Now, through electronic sources like ProQuest, in order to have access to that, you can't make a single purchase, right? You need to continue to subscribe to these resources year after year. Now, the the core resource, those newspapers are often out of copyright. They're technically free. What you're paying for is the particular platform or access point. And that concerns me because, as I said, some institutions and some students won't be able to afford it. Now, ProQuest has a right to make money, but they don't have a monopoly on these materials. And I would like to see more efforts by public and private educational institutions, as well as federal and state governments, to preserve these materials and make them freely or at least inexpensively available. This is not really a radical idea. We already do this with things like art museums, right? We fund art museums to preserve those works and to make them available to the public. So the idea that there should be a public responsibility for the materials that researchers use, both the ones from the past, but also the ones we're creating now, doesn't strike me as all that radical. In fact, we already, our own archives are, you know, subsidized by taxpayers. And so we're already making some progress in this area, but I think we can do more. Coordinated public efforts have the potential of not only lowering the cost of these materials, but also creating universal access portals that make learning how to use the sources easier. You know, there was a great editorial last night in the Hattiesburg American. I don't know if any of you caught it, but the Laurel Leader Call is going out of business, the Laurel newspaper. And a former editor at the paper has made arrangements to ensure that their morgue, their collection of old articles, won't end up in the dustbin. And if I could, if you wouldn't mind, I'll read a little bit from the editorial because I think it says a lot. He wrote, "The goal of salvaging those records from the scrap heap is to preserve them, digitize them, and one day make them available to people who need to utilize those records, and none more urgently than historians, genealogists, and the education community in the Jones County region." And then he pointed to a state effort, the Magnolia Database System, which has, as he said, I think accurately, quietly been funding these resources for some time. And so, again, progress is being made, but this was somewhat left up to somebody who had an emotional attachment. We need to be more systematic in preserving and making available these resources. But this can't all be about digitization and preservation. In addition, we need to value open source materials appropriately, and a number of my colleagues have pointed to this. In history, for example, the top journals are still owned and operated by historical associations that tie membership fees to journal subscriptions. Now, admittedly, providing these things costs money. There is peer reviewing to do, and there are physical publications to produce. But we shouldn't overstate those costs. You know, as everybody here has demonstrated, it can be done cheaply, it can be done more freely. And we need to stop treating those works that are freely available as if they're the poor country cousin. In other words, I think in history, and I believe in the humanities and the social sciences, that the real barrier to a further expansion of open source scholarship is the tenure and promotion committees turn up their noses at these publications. And we need to change that. I think we need to count these resources doubly, not discount them, but count them doubly. Because when it comes to evaluating what we do as scholars, there is an inherent added value, I believe, in resources that are freely available. Finally, I want to make one quick note, and we can follow this up maybe with in our conversation about textbooks, because it's possible to embrace these new models with textbooks as well. I'm currently applying for an exemption from our state textbook policy to try a new textbook. Now, this is a textbook that is published by the big publishers. The company that produces it, Flat World, is owned by Bertelsmann and Random House, but it publishes a textbook under a Creative Commons license. It makes that textbook available to everybody freely on the internet. Now, if students want to purchase a paper copy, they can pay for it. If they want an e-text, they can pay for it. And the company has a business model. But it lowers the cost. And for some students who are willing to read it online, it makes it free. You know, many of our students will spend as much as $600 a semester, even if they buy e-texts, even if they spend money on used copies, even if they cut corners, using more creative models, we have the potential of lowering that cost to well over under $200 a semester. And so we need to think about the way, not just our scholarly publications in the limited sense of the work that we produce for other scholars, but the work we produce for our students as well. So I think we're heading in the right direction with this platform at USM. I mean, I think we have the potential to do something exciting and new here. And I'm reminded that in the early 20th century, people went out in the streets and protested the fact that libraries and museums were closed on Sundays because people wanted access to information and to artwork and to the great things that scholars do. And I'm hoping that forums like this is the beginning of us demanding more access to the resources that we're producing today. Thank you.
I wanted to follow up on what you were saying about the ProQuest historical newspapers, because I have had several requests from our faculty about that, since it would provide those historical newspapers online. Our first concern is that the libraries have already invested in the microform editions of many of those papers. And I just wanted to share with you, when I actually explored the costs, each of the newspapers costs at least, at a minimum, of $60,000, and the entire set of historical newspapers cost $800,000, which is basically our entire journal's budget for a year.
For a resource we already own, which is...
And then, of course, it's the time, the effort, and the cost for staff if we actually try to digitize ourselves, which is partially where you come up with the same cost. So it's a very frustrating situation when you actually have the ownership and can perform it. Let me stop here and take any questions from the audience. Edward.
Yeah, concerning what you just said, I think it has to do with what we call institutional ego-tripping. We have 8 institutions in Mississippi. What we should do is to come up with some collaborative and what we call consortia planning.
Yeah, we don't do a good job of that in Mississippi.
We are all competing for the same resources.
Exactly.
It doesn't make sense.
In a previous life, I twice have worked in libraries in the Washington Research Library Consortium for the private universities in the Washington, D.C. area. And we really did meet and coordinate our collections and primary resources, core collections at each institution, so that we weren't buying the same thing, because our libraries offered daily delivery to one another for loaning, and the other efficiency of everything was online, so it could have that sharing across the institutions through one portal. But and I experienced the same thing for the 8 government-funded universities that I worked with in Hong Kong. We coordinated our collections because we had that shared portal. So there is a lot more we could do for coordination.
You know, I think the good news on this is that the journals are overplaying their advantage. They're charging so much that they're driving libraries that were reluctant to get involved in consortiums into consortiums, right? So I worked at a library in Boston many years ago now, when they were instituting a consortium there. I was working at Tufts University, which had one of the poorest libraries in the consortium, and we were always, the larger libraries were always reluctant to deal with us, right? They didn't want to pay for our resources. But now those larger libraries are feeling the pinch of high journal prices as well, which will force them to reconsider their policies and get more involved in consortia.
I think so.
Yeah, I want to just add on a related note that I think the presence of quite a number of open access journals would also make the traditional journal competitive, because
absolutely,
they are getting astronomical expenses. Mm-hmm. And the library cannot simply afford that. So So if you really have a quite a good number of open access journals, I think they would started, you know, improving their model probably. And that would, we the community would be benefited.
I think, I certainly see that happening. The only in-between stage that we're at that's very awkward for all of us is that we do have a lot of support to journals retrospectively through our databases that collect journal articles. The problem is that when it does have this high price or it's a commercial journal, then they embargo the last year or two or sometimes five, and we still have to try to get a subscription so that we have the availability of the current issues as well. So we're in this place where we're paying for the database, can we also afford to pay for the current issues of the journal? And I see this closing in where several have actually changed themselves to open access in a different situation. Dr. Haley, you mentioned, especially in history and several other fields as well, where the publisher is an association or a membership organization. And what happens, what you may not realize within the institutional setting, is that we have to pay a higher institutional membership because, of course, they're going, well, wait a second, you're only going to have one copy of the journal and 20,000 people using it. So we're going to charge you a 10, sometimes 20-fold membership price. So we have to have a membership. Then we have to pay for the subscription to the journal. So it ends up costing our institution even higher fees.
Is USM a member of the Coalition of OAM Policy Institution?
No.
Why? It's a faculty-led coalition. Why are we not?
Yes, there's a faculty assignment. I have seen a very strong effectiveness when, it was extremely highly cited and publicized when the College of Arts and Letters at Harvard made the mandate that they will publish everything published by the faculty open access, meaning that it was put into the institution or repository, and any kinds of fees by the commercial publisher that they were publishing in were supported by the college. So an entire process to make sure that, as Dr. Davis alluded to before, there was university support for author fees, but there was open access to the entire community of everything published by the faculty. Hugh.
Well, when I first heard of open access and digital repositories, I thought surely that's going to give scholars leverage with the traditional journals over time. Are we seeing any changes in copyright access to traditional journals as a result of things we're talking about?
No, not readily. There's still the very traditional situation. And as you said before, the very traditional tenure and promotion based on, and I think several of you have made the remark to me about the different standard of where you're publishing and what those publications are across different colleges. Someone mentioned a concern about that as well.
Yeah, and one thing that really hadn't been discussed much is the quality of the print itself. And I don't really know exactly how this has happened, but we were all concerned about internet information with no peer review process, nothing. You just post it, but somehow it's almost like self-regulated, and it's more accurate than we ever thought it would be when this first happened. And I think that's all connected to the mode of delivery, that mm-hmm. you do have access, so many people have access, that you can really keep information current and correct, and if something's wrong, there's a way to make that known. And so that, you know, to me, it seems like it's also increasing the rigor and the reliability of the print itself too.
Yeah, if you're not writing a reliable, well-researched blog,
somebody
you don't
will let
have
you know
anybody
soon.
Reading you.
Right.
So I think the example would be Wikipedia. You really
yeah.
find quite a huge amount of information. Now, of course, the onus is on us that how good they are to an extent. But yes, the open access has their value. An example would be Wikipedia. Who wants to ban Wikipedia? I'm not.
Not when it comes down to it. Yes.
Of quality and rigor, I think, has been a continuous
about this being a peer review process, because I didn't get that from a lot of the open access journals that I've looked at. It seemed more editorial or more self-publishing. So that's encouraging to me that we'll be able to see a change in the academy. One thing I was wondering, though, is with the print journals within specific disciplines, there tends to be a rating of A journals, B journals, based off of the reputation.
Especially business, for example.
Yes. So I was just wondering, are we going to see that with open access as well?
Well, if you go to the DOAR, there are citation figures, so they are trying to look at the general rankings and impact factors for the same kind of comparisons that you find for the commercially published. Another question I had, either for the panelists or audience, there also seems to be a movement, and I'm on the editorial board of the Elsevier Journal, and I received a notice yesterday for they really are looking at how does the peer review process need to change, and that's even for, they have both open access and commercial publications, well, World's Largest Publisher, and there's been several tests, especially in like science journals like Nature, for open peer review. And I think predominantly we've all been talking about peer-reviewed open access free journals, but it's kind of a new concept, and I really do see a moving trend towards open peer review, meaning in my own experience, I've only ever had closed peer review, where I was blind and the author was blind. But there seems to be this new trend towards you post the article, whether it's to a large group or even open on the internet, and the comments are made towards the article. So I didn't know if anyone had experience in working with open peer review.
No, but I just wanted to briefly talk about at least what is happening mm-hmm. in physical science journal. I think the open access ideas are new, at least in many of the fields. But if you look in physics or physical science, you already have for many years. For example, as we mentioned, that the ePrint archive, whatever you do, you can publish, it's free. It's originally started back in 1992 or 93. Then it was maintained by the Los Alamos, and now recently maintained by Cornell. And we already also have the so-called Stanford Public Information Retrieval System, or SPIRES. And in high energy physics, almost all paper you find it. So if you don't submit there, but it's in the journal, now the people who write the paper, they say, well, your paper is not in the SPIRES, I don't know that. So in physics, yes, the open access are already there, and those are not peer reviewed in any way. There are some kind of endorsement is there, but in the new open access, some of the other journals that are coming up, they are initiating the peer review, and I think over the time, some of the journal will survive and some will not, because there is a market, it's coming up like mushrooms. At the end of the day, some will survive, and they will be eventually as prestigious, I'm sure, that as some of the traditional journals. But the idea that it's open access is wonderful in a way.
And I think that's supported by what Dr. Bai was saying earlier about we'll see where this new journal
goes.
Right, yeah.
I want to ask a question of those in the sciences, because I want to understand better the difference between the sciences and the humanities and the kind of tradition here. And I think one thing that I understand is that to some degree the sciences have been doing this for years, right? Because you had pre-publication
yes.
resources where you shared information already kind of open access. There is no tradition in the humanities. Maybe somebody could speak to that, kind of how we got where we are in the sciences.
And the social sciences has the Social Science Research Network, which is very highly used among certain fields, like in businesses.
I think in the 1990s, the one important difference in science and in others, like in science, particularly in exact science, you don't give opinion. You actually say what you observe and you present the fact. Okay. And so that's why in the 1990s, in the high energy physics, it started with the high energy physics, they find that they wanted to, as fast they wanted to, you know, pass the information to the scientific community. And then some people started, okay, why don't we write some of the preprint? And this is all about I have done it. So that's what, and other people have started looking at that. So somehow it actually started working as soon as the internet comes up. And then it keeps going on ever since. And I mean, almost all of my papers are in a preprint archive. But of course, sometimes we find we have done some breakthrough work. We don't want to publish it wet, and let's get it to some of the top journal, because there are sometimes you all working on some of the projects, which is very close. You know that some of the other people are working on that. So at that point, but we do submit in preprint archive. And once we submit the preprint archive, we can still submit in, we submit in the paper, and the paper says that, okay, you cannot massively distribute that, but the preprint and the paper, revised paper, the difference is minimal in most cases. Okay. So I think there is no any kind of problem in sharing your preprint. Anyone can access what you have done. If they do not have the access to the journal, I immediately look for whether there is any preprint, and in most cases, I do get the preprint. So it's actually the beauty of the open access in a way.
A fun thing for us with our journal is that we also have a Facebook page. We get more hits with the Facebook page than probably the others, but that's what open access affords us to do.
And in fact, some of the traditional, very good, prestigious journal in science, they also charge an article processing fee.
Exactly. Mm.
So if they are already doing that, why not let's go for some of the open access and let's help them to, you know, be part of the peer review system, improve their standard, and go with that. At least the visibility high. If you are anywhere in the world where they cannot access these, some of the expensive journals, they can read your paper, and that's important. Mm-hmm.
So I want to add a few points in computer science and computational science, because in the past 10 years, this new technology, you know, has developed so fast. And this new area, for example, bioinformatics, you know, grows so fast in the past 10 years. And the traditional, you know, journal does not meet the need, because so many experts, so many scientists work in this area, including, you know, graduate program, graduate student, PhD student work in this area, are not funding. So traditional publication does not meet the need. And then the open access journals have been, you know, proposed, have been available for 10 years. And the quality of open access journals really depends on, you know, a lot of things. So I think one measure is the impact factor. So not all journals or open access journals can get an open, you know, impact factor. It takes years to build a good reputation, including review system, you know, editorial board, and the citation, especially the citation. So you need to build the record in order to get an impact factor. So new journal, you cannot get it, no way to get it. So this is a way, you know, how we, you know, submit our paper to a good open access journal. And then all these open access papers are available in the several database. So one is a PubMed I mentioned at the beginning. Another one, Digital Library, ACM, Digital Library, ICRP, Digital Libraries. So thanks, Corrie, for your strong support. So in our schools, so we'll move to all the digital library, so we can access that. So the quality really depends, you know, specific journals. So if you work in this area, you get another citation. We know that which journal in this area is higher quality or lower quality. So this depends on, you can make a decision which journal you need to submit your paper. Usually submit the first one, you know, and then not get accepted, you may revise that, submit it to a different journal.
What we discovered this year was that the students were not using our print copies of the Association of Computing Machinery journals, and of course it was limited to only a copy of Cook. So Dr. Zanya and I put our heads together and decided, well, let's try converting them to 100% online to the ACM Digital Library, where we're already seeing the faculty and students utilizing them and incorporating them into their courses more.
I think that's where things will change, even in my own area. So my dissertation was not ever printed. It was made available through the University of Pittsburgh's library system, first internally and then to the world. And in the humanities, where longer publications, book publications are so important, I think that process of digitizing dissertations may be the kind of gateway to open source publications later on, and something we should be encouraging.
Dr. Zhang also mentioned the journals that you work central. There's another factor that the faculty might want to explore, because an institutional membership with the Biomed Central also provides for the author payment support. So it does provide for the author fees with that membership and puts it within an institutional framework. So that's another factor that would be useful to discuss.
I just wonder if the Aquila digital community is peer reviewed here at USM.
No, it's not. The majority of the two major types of publications so far are previously published works. And I was going to address that. The faculty members have done one or two things. They either already have the author rights. In fact, this was kind of an audience question I was going to ask, whether anyone who has published in both books and journals has retained their copyright. You have the right to do that even if you're publishing commercially. One of our authors, for example, 75% of his works, he had the author rights to his works. The other percentage, he actually contacted the commercial publishers. In some cases, like the Taylor and Francis, he had to pay an author fee to obtain back the author rights to put his works into Quella. And he did so because he wanted the entire full text downloadable copies with permission. Another prolific faculty member in polymer science, the works are in Aquila, but not the tangible copy, if you will. It actually provides the link to the networked copy in the library. So you can't get to it in Manila, but if you're on the campus network anywhere in the world and a USM member, then you can authenticate yourself and be able to get to the library linked copy of the journal article, because all of those are commercial. But it is copyright acceptable to provide an electronic link to the already purchased copy.
So now a lot of those documents, like the previously published works, I mean, a lot of those are from peer-reviewed journals, so that the documents themselves may have gone through peer review in that spot.
Exactly.
We within ourselves are not managing.
We only have one self-published book, and I did it. It's the digital catalog of the library's museum collection. And so we made an electronic book and published it ourselves. But we're hoping that people feel free to do that, because you can use that base, that platform, for both original publishing or peer-reviewed works.
Am I correct that you've also made available the university's artwork?
Yes, exactly.
Online now, which
exactly.
Is it a major step towards making the kind of resources of the university more widely available?
The other exciting thing there is to encourage others in, like right now I have lots of interest in art and music and performing arts, for being able to capture their works as well. And then another major area that people are enjoying using it for is to promote their research works. So you have a research team, you can connect to the works that they might have previously done, or new projects that faculty want to promote, and it gives them a place to tell NSF where to look at, to see this is what we're planning, this is what we're applying for, these are our interests and credentials, so it gives them a place to highlight their research project. Yes,
is the new journal from the School of Library Science
mm-hmm.
part of
Yes, Willa. In fact, right now it has a high site. It's made it really visible. I don't know if they're signing it for school or if just there's a wide assortment of interest. But actually, we can see, Josh and I can actually see where the traffic's coming from. And it's not just within the university, it's a lot of outside interest in the newsletter for the School of Library and Information Science. And in that particular discipline, schools do look to each other to look at their news, so I'm assuming that, especially in North America, they have that interest. But it does, the platform gives us very detailed statistics on who's using it, where are they using it from? How many times has something been used or downloaded?
Corrie, isn't there report also sent to authors?
Yes. Sorry, I meant to add that.
When you submit your work to
when you submit your work,
get a report on how many access is there.
Right. In fact, Dr. Curry called one day and said, oh, there were two people from China who were using my article last month, so that was kind of interesting.
Yes, could I add to what you were saying?
Yes.
Well, it's not a newsletter, it's a journal. And what we do is we publish our graduate students' research that we deem are worthy to be published. Mm-hmm. And also we have some articles by faculty and some news items. So it's an 89-page journal.
Yeah. And the way that that works, because the platform itself was created by an electronic journal publisher, we basically give them the complete administrative control. So they're actually doing their own peer review process, selection, and then posting for publication. So each of the journals, Josh is working on converting another one right now from a print journal to an online journal. And we have interest among several other departments as well. Who did we talk to recently? Oh, at the Gulf Coast Research Labs. They have about 6 journals.
So in that case, the journal is peer reviewed.
Right.
Yes, exactly.
So I'm wondering how this changes things over time. Like when you started the Journal of Health Ethics, right?
Mm-hmm.
I got the title right. I mean, it must have seemed impossible, insurmountable, right? How am I going to make this available? I mean, the kind of technology, and maybe something like I'm always saying it wrong. Aquila is going to make that easier and make it more possible to do this kind of research.
Oh, I would think so. iTech was a very good support for me at the medical center. Unfortunately, when I moved from the medical center to USM, we didn't have the same connectivity, the same support from the server. The server at USM just could not support what we were doing, but we were able to find other things. But it's encouraging to me to know that Aquila exists. There's another platform here that
is
we can
still,
keep things.
Is it still, that's what I meant to ask you, is it still on a server at the medical center?
No, it's coming out of Canada.
Okay, so
mm-hmm.
Are you paying a source for
a very nominal fee. Less than $500
so you
a year.
Definitely talk to Josh and I.
Oh, I've met him. We've exchanged information. We have.
So, because it's giving you a lot more independence, and possibly you did allude to the fact that you have a lot of Google discoverability.
Exactly.
But because Aquila is working from a platform that's continually indexed, it is very discoverable. There's not a, if I'm looking for just a word that I know is among some of the papers that have been posted, I now find it within the top 3 hits in Google when I'm looking for it. I think there was another question from the audience.
I think it's somewhat going to answer a little bit, but I just was wondering when you were talking about between projects and Aquila, but it sounds like Aquila is just mostly for articles that have been identified.
You could write a book, you could have articles, we were the historical archives of events, for example, we just had the International Children's Book Festival, and we've created a site for them to archive presentations and documents from each year of the book festival, so archiving events as well. We'll do this one. And let's see. Yeah, we have galleries, so it has image gallery supports. It supports the publishing of journals, but most importantly, or the biggest use, is for faculty or students to be able to put their publications into a central platform.
And actually, regarding the students, we've actually partnered with the Honors College. They're hosting their honors theses on the site now.
Is there a limit as to what you can put there? I just completed a book, a children's book, Claudia and Grammy Lose Weight.
What?
Yeah. I won't tell you who Claudia, who Grammy is. But I just completed that, and I'm paying for that publication.
Yeah.
But to have it digitalized,
yeah,
you're saying that I can present
absolutely
that to a quote?
Yes.
They were going to charge $2,000 for that.
Broadband, or as the dean often says, I can't stand to click on YouTube because my broadband makes it keep trying to play.
That's good.
And I think that especially as we get more and more volume in Aquila, it's even slower to try to play videos or sound. And so I am working with iTech for a solution for a streaming server for video and sound, and that way we'd be able to point from Aquila to that, so it'd be transparent that it's sitting on another server, but I think for the sake of efficiency,
oh, that's great. That's good news.
We want to make sure that if we're providing support for things like the oral history project, that there's efficiency in the audio performance as well as for the whether it's music or performing arts.
I have comments about from campus to access to our library full text journal.
Mm-hmm.
Like article, if we like we find some journal, some article, we like to read the full text article, so we cannot click from there because we cannot access. We have to go to the library website, right, to download the full text.
No. It depends. We there's some resources that are so important to us that we have to compromise with the limitations of downloading or accessing the full text. In some cases, they have very high what are called digital rights management. They don't let you download it. They don't let you print more than a few pages. But that's one of the reasons that we pay. It's interesting. We pay premium price for Springer and Elsevier journals. And they are the two publishers who have absolutely no digital rights management. So if you're using an Elsevier journal in Science Direct, you just click on the button and download it. I had an economics professor I worked with a few years back that laughed and he said, do you know that I got rid of every file cabinet in my office? Because now I've managed to save every single article and book that I'm looking for in electronic form to my desktop. And so I no longer have a physical library. I only have a digital. For his personal research. Questions? Comments?
I have one. Are items that are in the new Aquila system, are they indexed by in the library catalog as well?
Some things are. Some items are in the library catalog, but many of the authors have in some, well, I'd say the majority of cases they're pre-published. You know, they're already commercially published.
Mm-hmm.
They've already been peer-reviewed. They're in another publication. It's just a platform where they're republishing themselves.
But and I forget the title of the children's book, but would the children's book, for example,
right,
end up in the catalog?
If we added it to the library collections.
Mm-hmm. So that's a separate process.
So, yeah,
yep.
we haven't looked at Aquila as the library collection. It's the university's collection. So some items are cataloged and others aren't. But it's a consequence. It hasn't been a practice on our part to physically catalog the article or books. So it'd kind of be up to the individual author.
Oh, it's coming.
Well, again, thank you all very, very much. I really appreciate it. Excellent audience.
Enjoyed your presentation.
Thank you.